those, and what we're going to do, we're going to have a word of prayer, and then we're just going to take time and go through some of these questions that have already been asked, and then we'll open up the floor if we have time, and I think we'll have a little time for any questions you all have. And I'm sure that you probably have great things to share, but let's begin with prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the opportunity we have to come together again. We certainly appreciate you. We appreciate all you do for us and your love and compassions and mercy. We thank you for your Spirit guiding and directing us today so far, for touching hearts and opening up hearts, and we pray that you will continue to do that to my heart and every heart here. Especially bless our young people, that
yes,
the scriptures and things we share will be a blessing to them, and I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I have two questions, sort of, so I'm going to begin. But before I do that, I'd like to read a text from the book of John. John chapter 14 and verse 29. And I don't think we've heard this text given in any of the talks yet today, or, well, this week even, maybe. But I think it's a very interesting text. He says, "And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it is come to pass, ye might believe." And so sometimes we think of prophecy as something that just teaches us what the future is going to be. But Jesus says prophecy is actually a faith-building experience. I know that Pastor David was speaking on the seven, Daniel chapter 7, those four great world empires on Wednesday night. And he said, how can anyone not believe in God and see all this? Amen. It's designed to build faith. I'll just say this, that these great prophecies were probably much more written for us than those people living at that time, because we have the advantage of being way past the fulfillment of most of them. And we can see how exactly they were fulfilled, and it builds our faith. So Jesus says, I've told you these things before they come to pass, that when they do, you might believe. Now I have a question here that I thought was a really nice question. It says, how do I know what questions to ask? Now, that's not facetious. I think it's an honest question. I'm going to treat it like an honest question. But I believe that one thing we need to understand is that God is a God of dialogue. In Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18, he says, come now and let us what?
Reason
together. God wants to talk to you. Yeah. He wants to talk to you. And prayer is the way that we talk to God. And we had a text on the screen in the last meeting, Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3. What does that say? Do you remember? He says, call upon me and I will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. So he wants us to come to him. And I just want to read a little section from the book Steps to Christ on page 100. And I think it's just a beautiful thought. It says, keep your wants, your joys, your sorrows, your cares, and your fears before God. Bring those to him. You know, what do we pray about? What are the things that we can pray about? Well, we can pray about our cares, our fears, our joys, our sorrows. You cannot burden him. You cannot weary him. He who numbers the hairs of your head is not indifferent to the wants of his children. The Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. His heart of love is touched by our sorrows and even by our utterance of them. So he's touched not only by what hurts us, but when we speak it to him, it touches him. Take to him everything that perplexes the mind. Everything. Nothing is too great for him to bear, for he holds up the worlds. He rules over all the affairs of the universe. And now I like this. This is one of my favorite statements in all of the book Steps to Christ and in Spirit of Prophecy. Nothing that in any way concerns our peace is too small for him to notice.
Amen.
Maybe our young person has a hamster and the hamster's sick.
Mm-hmm.
It's not too small for God to notice.
Amen.
Maybe my car payment's not getting made on time.
That's right.
It's not too small for him to notice. Maybe my children are walking in the wrong path. He certainly notices it. But nothing that affects our peace is too small for him to notice.
Amen.
So our young people, whatever affects you, whatever touches your heart, it touches him, because we are the apple of his eye. It says, there is no chapter in our experience too dark for him to read. There is no perplexity too difficult for him to unravel. No calamity can befall the least of his children. No anxiety harass the soul. No joy cheer, no sincere prayer escape the lips of which our Heavenly Father is unobservant or of which He takes no immediate interest. He takes an immediate interest. You know, sometimes we think God delays an answer to the prayer. And sometimes He does delay the answer, but it's not because He is not observing that prayer. He takes an interest in it immediately. So you can bring all your fears, all your sorrows, all your joys, all your concerns to God and talk to Him in prayer. And I'm just so thankful for that. I had another question that's very similar to it, and I think it's already been answered in the same respect. So now we have these other men that are going to do this, and I'm going to give them the mic.
Okay, this is a great question. I don't know who asked it. You don't have to raise your hand, but it is interesting. The question is, how is it that you can never do anything to be saved, but what you do can cause you to be lost? That's a deep question, isn't it? So anyway, I'm just going to read some Bible verses that hopefully shall speak for themselves. Titus 3, 5 and 6. It says, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy He saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which He shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior." So there it says that it's not by works of righteousness that we're saved, but it's according to His mercy that He saved us. So salvation is not attained by your works. That's a dangerous error. Galatians chapter 2, verse 16, it says, "Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by works of the law." By the works of the law. "For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified." So, good point, whoever wrote this question. Our works will not save us. That's not what saves us. That's what the Bible tells us. But now notice this, James 2:14. "What do the prophet..." Actually, this is several verses. I think it's 14 to 18 or somewhere in there. "What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, Depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone." Now remember, we read that we're saved by faith, the faith of Jesus Christ. Are we saved by dead faith?
No.
Dead faith is faith that doesn't do anything. But the Bible says faith works by love. Anyway, so here it says, "Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, Thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works." So the point that you get here is that faith works. Faith is demonstrated by our works. If you have real living faith, it's gonna be noticeable. Revelation 20, verse 13 says, "And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man, according to their works." So the works are going to come up in the judgment. And the works are going to demonstrate whether we have faith or not, whether we have living faith or dead faith. Galatians 5, 16 to 21, it says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are..." Oh, that got repeated. "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations." I know those words are big and kind of difficult, but they all have deep meaning. "Wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." So there it's really clear from the Bible that if you're doing those things, those are works, if you're doing those negative works, you're not going to heaven. And that demonstrates that you don't have faith. You don't have living faith. Because if you had living faith, look what happens. Galatians 5:22 to 24, it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit..."
Sorry,
Like book and like verse and all that was that?
That one we just read was Galatians 5, 16 to 21. And you're welcome. And now we're looking at Galatians 5, 22 to 24. And here it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and the lusts. So if you really have faith in Christ, if you've accepted Christ into your heart, then Christ is going to be living in you. And your life is going to demonstrate that. Your works are going to demonstrate that. So anyway, if you have bad works, it's just evidence that you have a bad heart. Jesus said, out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, all these things come out of the heart. And it's the heart that needs to be transformed. As somebody was really well, I think that was S.T. Lewis sharing this morning, how important it is to have Christ living in you. Mm. So anyway, I hope that answers the question. I don't know who asked it, but...
Maybe you claim Psalms 51, creating a clean heart instead of a dirty heart.
Yes, that's a good point. Creating me a clean heart, oh God. When I used to be a drug addict, and at that time, I didn't want to be a Christian because I thought that'd be boring, you know. I wanted to do all the fun stuff I was doing, and I didn't think I wanted to. But what I didn't realize is that when I ask God for a new heart, my set of likes and dislikes is changed. I start liking things I didn't like before, and that's what happened. It was really amazing transformation. When I asked God to give me a new heart, my life was different. I didn't go to parties anymore. I didn't go and get drunk and all that stuff that I was doing in the past. And that was just demonstrating what happened in my heart. I was transformed, so.
My question is, how do you know what career path God wants you to pursue, even if you are already praying? If there is no clear answer, does it meant you are already in the right place?
Can you all hear Elvis in the back okay?
If you would repeat it, that would be great.
Repeat it again?
From the diaphragm. Got to get more volume.
Okay. How do you know what career path God wants you to pursue, even if you are already praying? If there is no clear answer, does it mean you are already in the right place? That's the question. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 1 and verse 6. Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 1 and verse 6. It says, my son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. And verse 6 it says, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. He answered career and path. Then God will be not wise in thy own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Verse 7 and verse 6 says, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. And Letters 35, 1893, Spirit of Prophecy. It gives commentary on verse 6 to make it more clear for us. God guides us in doing his will. Has not God said he would give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? That's the question. And is not this Spirit a real, true, actual guide? Some men seem afraid to take God at his word, as though it would be presumptuous in them. They pray for the Lord to teach us, and yet are afraid to credit the pledged word of God and believe we have been taught of him. So long as we come to our Heavenly Father humble and with a spirit to be taught, willing and anxious to learn, Why should we doubt God's fulfillment of his own promise? You must not for a moment doubt him and dishonor him thereby. When you have sought to know his will, your part in the operation with God is to believe that you will be led and guided and blessed in the doing of his will. We may mistrust ourselves lest we misinterpret his teachings, but make even this subject of prayer and trust him. Still trust him to the uttermost, that his Holy Spirit will lead you to interpret aright his plans and the working of his providence. Is it clear? Can my father, my mother, my sister give a better guide than the Holy Spirit? And there is a lot of quotation also in spiritual prophecy. One of these quotations that I remember, but I don't remember the reference, but it says, if in our life we decided to do nothing that displeases our Heavenly Father, when we offer our prayers to God, we will know exactly what path to follow.
Sarvages 6:68.
I remember.
Mm-hmm. Can I just follow up on something in connection with what you said? Do you think God at times uses parents to help guide their children? Mm-hmm.
Sure, sure. If the parents permit the Holy Spirit to guide them also in their counsels.
Okay. Thank you.
And also, God can speak to us directly what path to choose. Do we believe that?
Amen.
Did we have the experience that God called us by name and tells us what to do? I have that experience many times. I remember for just a testimony. I remember some years ago, my father had a bad heart problems. And they decided that he have to go for a surgeon in Colombia. And then they asked me to go with my father. And then I was preparing, but one night I got a message. God said, Elvis, now you go and work in South America. Clear. He called me by my name. Say, Elvis, now you go and work in South America. Normally I work from Curaçao to Europe, in Holland, Germany, and Belgium. And I say, in South America, I don't have any connection in South America. And then that same week, Pastor Allen called me and tell me, Elvis, could you go and work with me in South America? And I was for 41 days in South America, traveled back and forth with Pastor Allen, translated all the time from English, Spanish, and so on. And many times I have received message directly from God, call me by my name. And in Psalm 121, it says, God knows each one of us by name.
Right.
Commentary on Psalm 121. And God can call, and when God calls, Elvis, do this. And many times I got called directly with me. So those who need to like to have direct answer, that God guide them path, they can just pray and trust our Heavenly Father that he work through his Holy Spirit to guide us on our path.
Okay.
Is that clear?
So, good morning or good evening, good afternoon, everyone. And so the question that I received was, how should we handle people if they are teaching untruth? I repeat it. How should we handle people if they are teaching untruth? The first point that I want to establish is that there are two kinds, I would say. For example, people can say, oh, we all want to wear brown socks, you know. That's mandatory. You know, that's not the gospel. That's not what the gospel is about. And sometimes we are making small issues and we make them big issues, you know. But the Bible speaks about the doctrine, the sound doctrine. And the first verse that I want to share with you is 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 10. Because when, 1 Timothy 1:10, because I brought that point in my last presentation, and he said in verse 8, but we know that the law is good if a man uses it lawfully, knowing this, that the law is not made for the righteous man, but for the lawless. And he goes on with many characteristics, and he finished in verse 10, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine. Mm-hmm. So, sound doctrine means sound teacher. And bad doctrine also means false teacher. It implies false teacher. So, this point, the first point that I wanted to establish is that it is a serious issue. Because a false teaching will lead us in will lead us to live against the law, okay? And in 1 Corinthians 13 verse 6, 1 Corinthians 13 verse 6, maybe some of us know that verse, 1 Corinthians 13 verse 6. And there we read, and the reason why I before reading that verse, it's because when we do not respect, when we do not obey God's law, we are enemy of God. That's right. And Jesus tells us that we need to love our enemy. So keep in mind that with all human beings, we need to show love. Is it that clear for you?
Yes.
We need to show love. But once we have established that, we need to know what love is and what love is not. And that's what I want to read with you, one characteristic of love. And love, not a feeling, but a principle that Paul wrote in this chapter. And it is the love agape. And most of you maybe heard about it. So, and this is this Greek word that John used to say that God is love, agape. And in verse 6, he said, rejoice not in iniquity, but rejoice in the truth. So, the true love, the love of God, in which the Spirit of God will lead us into, will lead us to not rejoice in iniquity. So we will, there is, this will lead us to have a certain behavior toward the false teacher. And interestingly, the Greek word translated by rejoice in this verse is kerios. And it is this verse, it is this word, kerios, which was translated by God for Godspeed in 2 John 1, verse 10. Go with me, please, in 2 John 1 and verse 10. And we read that in the last presentation. Oh, I think it's, Second John. 1:10. Okay, so, and there we read, if there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. So here, the Greek word which was translated by Godspeed is kerios, the same which was translated by rejoice, the first rejoice in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 6. So, what John wrote here was inspired by God's love. Okay? I just want to take an example for you. If a prostitute asks me to have fun with her, do you think that it will be to show love to have fun with her? No. It won't be love. I have to love her because it is a soul to win to Christ. But I cannot have, you know, bad things like that. And this is the same thing for false teacher. We have to love them as men. We have to, they are soul to win because they are leading people to iniquity and thus to be condemned. But we cannot rejoice with them. We cannot share the pulpit with them. And just another quotation, and I just read it. It's Matthew 18, verse 15 to Jesus said, "Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he shall neglect to hear thee, tell it unto the church. But if he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee as an heathen man and a publican." So this love will lead us to have a behavior to try to gain that people who are teaching untruth. But as soon as these people take stand for that and don't want to listen anything, we will not constrain this person to do the contrary of what he wants to do. So we have to let him, and we'll have sorrow, like Pastor Allen shared with us. We'll weep about that, and maybe we will cry about it, but we will certainly not rejoice with that. And true love will not lead us to rejoice, to share the pulpit with false teacher. And I just want to share with you a last thing, and it is a quotation of Ellen White in early writing. And I ask you, please, to read this, the whole chapter of False Shepherd in early writing. And I will just read one or two paragraphs. And it's early writing, page 124, paragraph 3. And there she said, "I was shown the necessity of those who believe that we are having the last message of mercy being separated from those who are daily imbibing new errors. I saw that neither young," and it's a young who gave us this question, "neither young nor old should attend their meetings, for it is wrong to thus encourage them while they teach error that is a deadly poison to the soul, and teach for doctrines the commandment of men. The influence of such gathering is not good. If God has delivered us from such darkness and error, we should stand fast in the liberty wherewith he has set us free and rejoice in the truth. God is displeased with us when we go to listen to error without being obliged to go. For unless he sent us to those meetings where error is forced home to the people by the power of the will, he will not keep us. The angels cease their watchful care over us, and we are left to the buffeting of the enemy, to be darkened and weakened by him and the power of his evil angels, and the light around us became contaminated by the darkness." And she continued, but I ask you to read that chapter, because this is just what the Bible basically tells us, but she explained it in with more details. But for me, this is what the Bible teach, and I just show you that. So we need to love each human beings, and this love will not lead us to rejoice with those who want willingly, after we show them that it is a mistake. We show them by the Bible, by evidence. They want to teach that. We let them, but we'll not partake with them. And this is also a token for them. Because if we said, oh, we are not agree, but I still take the pulpit with you, what kind of sign are we giving?
How would Romans 16, 17 compare to that idea?
Yeah. It relates to Romans 16, 17, yeah, also. So it's you can compare it, Romans 16, 17 with 2 John 1, 10 and 11. And so I hope that I respond the question. And may God give us His love, His true and pure love, so that we can love each human beings and take pleasure in the truth and not rejoice in iniquity. God bless
Titus
us.
3:10.
Titus 3:10.
That was another text on the
verses. Yeah. I'll read it. A man that is an heretic after the first and second admonition rejects. Of course, yeah. It was saying basically the same thing that Matthew 18, 15 to 17. But for me, First Timothy 1:10 is basically for me an important verse because, again, false teacher will lead people in sin. And I repeat that. False teacher will lead people in sin. And I don't think it's you know, that will not help us for the end of the time that in which we are. So,
my question is simply, what does the Bible say about music? Before I answer the question directly, I want to just show a few thoughts here. Professor Marshall McLuhan says the medium is the message. That is to say, the music, its melody, harmony, and rhythm all by itself disposes man to virtue or vice by moving the emotions. Okay? So the elements of music, melody, harmony, rhythm, each one can move you to virtue or vice by moving the emotions. A brain specialist, Dr. Richard Pellegrino, says, trigger a flood of human emotions and images that have the ability to instantaneously produce very powerful changes in emotional states. Take it from a brain guy and 25 years of working with the brain, I still cannot affect a person's state of mind the way that one simple song can. Dr. Norman Weinberger says, music can rapidly and powerfully set moods and do so in a way not easily attained by other means. And now the servant of the Lord says that if the thoughts are wrong, the feelings will be wrong. The thoughts and the feelings combined make up the moral character. Do we want an external stimuli that we have that we are not in charge of, controlling our emotions and thus helping to form our moral character? We were on a bus and going to a camp meeting, and there was a video playing in the front of the bus at a very, very loud volume, as is typical there.
Yeah.
And we had our children with us, etc. And it was one concert after another, two concerts. The first was Michael Jackson. And the next was Lady Gaga. And I have heard before, going in stores and whatever, little snippets of their songs. But just the unavoidable glances that you see when you're on a bus and it's right smack in front of you, I saw things that were horrifying, that were accompanying the music, that I never dreamed would be shown, and my kids were watching it. I mean, unavoidably, we were trying to keep them from watching it. And we, these things cannot but help to, I mean, not, they have to affect your moral character. There is no way around it. If we are choosing to let these things come into us, when we decide that as Christians we are not required to restrain our thoughts and feelings, we are brought under the influence of evil angels and invite their presence and their control. This says rhythm is the element of music most closely allied to body movement, fleshly, carnal, to physical action. Its simpler patterns, when repeated over and over, can have a hypnotic effect on us. It puts us in a trance-like state. And that's a state where the mind, the frontal lobe, is no longer judging the things that are coming in. It's no longer filtering the things that are coming in. That trance-like state allows things to come in unfiltered, and that makes up this computer what it is. And unfortunately, there's no delete button. There's no trash can, other than the power of God. Amen. So
are you saying, David, that all music is bad, we shouldn't have music because it controls us in bad ways?
No, I'm saying that it has a very powerful effect.
Can it have a positive effect?
And I'll answer that in a moment from Scripture.
Okay.
But I just want to show one other element. We talked about rhythm. Just a simple song. The key of C, Jesus loves me. Okay, same key. Jesus loves me. Same key, but a different chord. If you hear those two of the notes in that chord played alone, you can definitely hear they're dissonant. When you add a few others, this creates emotion. It actually causes hormones to be produced, altering your mood. And so my first point is simply music can have a very powerful effect in various ways. The rhythm, the harmony, the melody, all of it. Scripturally, in Numbers chapter 25, verse 18, it speaks about how they were beguiled in the matter of Peor. This is in the days of Balaam.
Yeah.
Over in chapter 31, verse 16, it tells us, behold, these caused the children, speaking of the women, caused the children of Israel through the counsel of Balaam to commit trespass against the Lord in the matter of Peor. And there was a plague among the congregation of the Lord. This is talking about an instance where Balaam was asked to come over and curse the children of Israel. God turned his curses into a blessing. He wasn't able to curse them, so he resorted to counseling the king of Moab, do this and this. And what they did following that counsel was they held a feast and to their gods, invited the children of Israel to come and just witness the ceremony. Just show your friendship. Just show that you're friendly. And so they did. In Patriarchs and Prophets, it tells us that they were beguiled, like it says here. They were beguiled with the music, and then the dancing, and then it went to drinking wine, the intemperance, the gluttony, and then it went to fornication, and pretty soon they were bowing down to idols. One step led to another, and it began with the beguiling effects, the changes in the mood, the feelings, which alter the thoughts caused by the music. So music can have a very powerful effect. And music is mentioned in the Bible in connection with worship. Both worship in a positive sense, worship of the true God. For example, in the days of David, 2 Chronicles 15, I believe it is one example.
Chronicles what?
2 Chronicles 15. Let me just go here again to make sure. Okay. Let's look at verse 14. They swear unto the Lord with a loud voice and with shouting, with trumpets and with cornets. And that's not exactly the one I was looking for, but it spoke about David assigning different musicians and anyway, I don't need to take time necessarily to go into that right now. If you want to know more, come to Waldensian Center, and when we reopen to our missionary school, this slide presentation that I just showed you a little snippet of was part of many series that Thomas and Raquel put together some years ago for Waldensian Center, and we have a whole series on music and how to discern good from bad music. And it's not something you can learn just in a few moments here, but the point is, it can be a blessing or it can be a curse. We have another example. I just want to mention the example of when King Herod had Herodias come in. She was dancing, or his lover had her daughter come in, who was dancing before him, and of course what accompanies dancing is music. And this so enraptured him, entranced him, is the word I was looking for, and that combining that with the intemperance, he was willing to put to death a man of God, a prophet of God. And so we have to be very guarded when it comes to music. And this can be, there's a lot of music that falls into the category of Christian music, which is not Christian at all. And that's because we have to judge more than, as we were seeing, more than just the lyrics, but also the music itself. Yes, Todd.
I was going to say, then you have the other side of that, where David came and played for Saul, and the music calmed him down.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's examples of taking it both directions.
That's right. And
the other aspect, I think, I know what you want to touch on, is about the beat itself many times. You played some chords and what have you, but, you know, in drums and what have you, you have a beat, okay, that can be that hypnotic effect and whatnot as well.
Yeah, I mentioned that in the last slide that I showed, the rhythm, which also includes the beat.
We would say that all music has a certain amount of rhythm, but its rhythm is balance, like the minimum part of music. And when it becomes too much, it's too much, for sure.
Yeah, they need
emphasis.
There needs to be a proper ratio of the different elements of music, melody, rhythm, and harmony. And when those are out of balance, then you have bad music. And there's a proper ratio that needs to be considered in those things. And then there are different kinds of rhythm, different kinds of harmony, etc. All of this needs to be considered.
My question was given to me because of my experience in the past, and it has to do with being single. And I have to share a testimony. It's got lost somewhere in my tent, unfortunately. But I'm paraphrasing it. Yeah.
What does the Bible say about being single?
Yeah. Besides 1 Corinthians chapter 7, what other statements in the Bible talk about being single? And before I go into the statements in the Bible, my experience is patience. You know, Jesus says, "In your patience possesses ye your souls." And there's nothing more important than getting married to someone and spending the rest of your life with that person. So, this statement by Jesus really should come home to all of us who are single. I'm not single anymore, but. So in your patience possesses your soul. So I came to the Lord at age 30. I was never married, even in the world. From when I became 18 years old to 30, I remained single. And I believe the Lord was even working upon my heart then. So at the age of 30, I came into the Sabbath, came to Jesus. And then I came to the Sabbath truth in January of 2006. And so for 10 years, I waited patiently for my wife, not expecting. You know, I told the Lord, if you want me single for the rest of my life, then that's what you would have me to be. But it worked out differently. But our mindset has to be, as Paul says, in whatever state you are, be content. You know, this is important, especially for the youth. Many youth want to rush into relationships and rush into things which, without experience, without being grounded, without parental guidance as well. And we're told in the Proverbs chapter 20, turn there, chapter 26, I believe. Verse 19 says, "Hear thou, my son, and be wise, and guide thine heart in the way." And then it gives other counsel. And then it goes down to 24, says, "The father of the righteous shall greatly rejoice, and he that begetteth a wise child shall have joy of him." And verse 25, "Thy father and thy mother shall be glad, and she that bare thee shall rejoice." And verse 26, "My son, give me thine heart, and let thine eyes observe my ways." So as parents of young people, it doesn't end when we turn 18. It only begins, really, because there's more counsel that is needed, more wisdom that is needed in these ages than even in the earlier years when you're dealing with this issue of marriage and having giving your children's hand in marriage to another. So the children need to be always, if you have righteous parents, you need to be seeking counsel from the parents, and the parents will help you and to prevent maybe a catastrophe from happening and marrying the wrong person. And I want to turn now to what Jesus says. We know based on two or three witnesses a thing shall be established. And we know 1 Corinthians chapter 7 talks about being single, but what does their master say? What does Jesus say? Let's turn to Matthew chapter 19, verse 12. Well, let's read the context a little bit, if we have a little time. It says in verse 7, "They say unto him, Why did Moses then command to give a writing of this divorcement and to put her away? He saith unto them, Moses, because of the hardness of your heart, suffered you to put away your wives, but from the beginning it was not so. And I say unto you, whosoever shall put away his wife, except it be for fornication, and shall marry another, committeth adultery. And whoso marrieth her which is put away doth commit adultery. His disciples say unto him, if the case of the man be so with his wife, it is not good to marry. Now, do you think the disciples were taking an extreme position, saying, well, we can't marry. Of course they were. They've been taught by the Pharisees and the scribes about this divorcement issue, so that they could put away anybody. But now Jesus is reinstating what happened in the garden, in marriage. And then Jesus says, but he said unto them, all men cannot receive this saying, save they to whom it is given. For there are some eunuchs, verse 12, which were so born from their mother's womb, and there are some eunuchs which were made eunuchs of men, and there be eunuchs which have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. He that is able to receive it, let him receive it. So Jesus is saying that if you're able to receive it, he's not saying you have to receive it, or that this is direct counsel to everybody to be single for the Lord's sake and for his work, but if you're able to, and it's God's will for your life, then be content with that position and enjoy the work that God has given you to do. So we are to be happy single, happy married, and let the Lord open up the door for the right person to come into your life, and not rush it. The important part is be patient.
Yes.
Be patient.
Thanks, Brother Mark. Brother Andy has a simple but complex question.
Absolutely. I just want to make a compliment for my husband's talk. I think if we young people read the Adventist home, that will answer a lot of questions. In chapter 6, the title is The Great Decision. It is a great decision to get into marriage with sacred.
My wife says that to read Adventist Home, all the young people, chapter 6, and I would also say Messages to Young People as well. So, and that'll help you in help guiding you in that decision as well.
And just a short sentence, if I could say, before ever getting involved, counsel with somebody.
Yes.
Because once your affections are involved, it's almost impossible. It is impossible, humanly speaking, but not with God. But it's very difficult to make a rational decision or to step out of a situation once your affections are involved. So counsel with other people that are third parties, that are not emotionally involved, before you get to that point where you're not going to be able to get out of it, even if you know it's wrong.
Mm-hmm. My question basically is, why does God feel so far away from us sometimes? And you know, all these questions have been superb and powerful, very well thought out. This question is kind of like telling a doctor, my stomach hurts, what's the problem? Based on just that. There could be any number of issues that are going on. And so I'm not going to take the time to touch on all of the different things that could be going on, but there were some things that really jumped out at me that I was thinking of. Psalm 66:18 says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. There's two things I want to draw out of this. Number one, prayer. Prayer is one of the most important things that can ever be done. If you look at all the men and women that have turned this world right side up in history, one thing that they have in common is extreme prayer time with God. Every last one of them, 3 hours, sometimes more, on a regular basis. And so I can't overemphasize prayer time. But the other thing, you know, there could be a series of things. So ask yourself, what is my prayer time? How much am I reading and studying the Word of God? How much time am I spending with God? You know, it could be that you're not spending enough time with God, that this is why you don't feel him close. But it could be because there's iniquity in the heart also. Micah 3:4 says, then shall they cry unto the Lord, but he will not hear them. He will even hide his face from them at that time, as they have behaved themselves ill in their doings. So there could be a possibility that there is iniquity that we have in our heart that we know of, and we're just not dealing with it. And so God, we're blaspheming the Spirit at that point, if you will. We're eventually pushing the Spirit away, and this could be why we're not feeling the presence of God. So again, there could be many different things. But something, you know, you ask yourselves these things. Is there something standing in the way? You always have to ask yourself that. Is there something standing in the way? But there are times when there is nothing standing in the way, and you still don't feel the presence of God. And here I'm emphasizing the word feel. And I'm emphasizing that for a reason. Matthew 27:46 says, "And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice." And I won't pronounce that. Yes. That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus here felt forsaken. But was God far off, or was he close to him at this point? He was close to him. We back up one verse into 45, and it says, "Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour." And you can compare that with many different verses in the Psalms and whatnot. But I like 2 Samuel 22:10 says, "He bowed the heavens also and came down, and darkness was under his feet." So when we compare these verses, we find that this is when God was the closest to Christ. But he felt forsaken. So I guess my emphasis would be, if you read through the Bible and find out, is there something standing between me and God? Is there something I'm doing, something I'm not doing? Prayer, study, iniquity, any other thing. If you cannot find those things and you're sure that there's nothing there, then don't go by your feelings. We must, by faith, perceive that he is there. Where two or three are gathered together, do we see him here? Do we see Jesus in our midst? But there's the promise. Jesus is here. Do I have to feel him to know he's here? No, I don't have to feel him to know that he's here. I know by faith. And so in those instances, like the footsteps poem, I think we know the footsteps poem. You know, we look back and there's one set of tracks, and the cry goes forward, why were you not with me in these hard times? And Jesus says, basically, my son, that's when I was carrying you. So again, feelings are there, they're important, but they cannot override the knowledge or the faith. And so we have to have the knowledge. And if we don't have that knowledge, then you got to go back to the Word of God. Everything's going back to that.
I'll read. My question is kind of a long question. And it's a question that I'm sure many of us, if not all of us, if we've encountered not only those in the faith, but those outside of the faith, in regard to our faith in Christ, have heard. And it's this: how can God know everything and yet let the world continue as it is?
Good question.
And the answer is simple, but not so simple, I guess. The answer simply is God is love. That is why. But the problem with the question, and it's not that the problem, the question isn't a legitimate question, it is. But the direction of the question is wrong. The focus of the question is at God, when the focus of the question ought to be us. And I want to just share with you a couple thoughts. I wrote these down. Just because I've encountered this question so much, I felt impressed to write something on it. First, I want to address the idea of God knowing all things. In 1 John 3:20, it tells us God knoweth all things. How it is that God knows all things is not given to me or to any man to know or to understand, save that he is God. This is all I or any man need to know. If God did not first know all things, he could not then declare the end from the beginning. Isaiah 46:10. It is by his knowing all things that he's able to declare what shall be. This is also why his word or prophecy is called a more sure word, 2 Peter 1:19. And it is because his word is sure and he knoweth all things, he therefore cannot lie. Titus 1:2. However, knowing all things does not make us either good or evil. It simply makes us all-knowing. Knowledge is nothing more than power, and power alone does not make one good or evil. It simply makes them powerful or full of power. It is how one uses that knowledge or power that determines whether that person is good or evil. This is why God alone is perfect in knowledge. Job 36:4. Because God alone uses all his knowledge aright, or perfectly. You see, God has not asked man to know or to understand all things he has said, but to believe all things he has said. This is love, because as we shared earlier from verse 6, love, or charity, believeth all things. To us finite beings, knowledge and understanding can only come by faith. Knowledge never comes by doubt or skepticism. This is why we must believe God. We must take him at his word, because his word is sure. This is the faith which is well-pleasing to God, that we not only believe that he is, but that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. That is, we must believe that God is good, that God is love, 1 John 4:8 and verse 16. This too is why without faith it is impossible to please him, Hebrews 11:6. Because whatsoever is not of faith is sin, Romans 14:22 and 23. There was a man who brought his lunatic son to Jesus to be healed. And Jesus said unto him, all things are possible to him that believeth. This poor man, tormented by the thought that his unbelief or doubt might cost him the life of his dear son, cried out to Jesus, Lord, I believe. Help thou mine unbelief. Mark 9:24. Our faith, like that of this trembling father, must feel its great need. He believed Jesus' word. He believed that Jesus' words were true. Yet he knew that his faith in that word was not perfect. Therefore he cried, help thou mine unbelief. This man not only saw the truth of Jesus' words, but he also saw, by the words of Jesus, that his own fear and doubt had brought not only himself, but his son to his present condition. Such faith is well-pleasing to God, because it is the sincere confession of an honest heart, and because it rests itself solely upon the word of God. Such must be the prayer of every sincere soul who would ask of God anything. Yet just as it was with the man who brought his son to Jesus, so it also must be with us, beloved. Before we can believe, we must first hear and listen to what the Lord has to say. For faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, Romans 10:17. And I want to close with just one more example from Scripture. In Matthew, the 26th chapter, verse 31, Jesus and his disciples had just got done praying and singing a hymn, and they departed for Gethsemane. On the way, Jesus told them these words, all ye shall be offended because of me this night. Question, did Jesus lie to his disciples? What's your answer?
No.
No. Of course he didn't. Certainly not. God's word had spoken, and God's word is truth. Amen? John 17:17. Mm-hmm. Did his disciples know and understand Jesus' meaning?
No.
Let us hear Peter. Though all men shall be offended because of thee, yet will I never be offended. Verse 33. You see, Peter and the other disciples understood the meaning of Jesus' words, but they did not understand them according to truth, but in accordance with their own view of themselves. What then was the problem? What caused them all to fail and be offended in Jesus? Because they did not hear the truth? No, they all heard it. Certainly not. God, in all his knowledge, had revealed to them their need. But they refused to believe. Herein lies the cause of this world's sorrow and misery. Sin, sorrow, death, and all that is evil and vile does not lie at the feet of God. For God, in his all-knowing love, has revealed to this world both life and death. As it is written, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. Deuteronomy 30:19. You see, beloved, the problem isn't with God. It is with us. The reason this world is in the condition it is, that there's sin and vileness and corruption, is not because of God's all-knowing. But God's all-knowing love has revealed the reason for these things. But the problem is our unbelief. We don't believe. Even when we're told the truth, we won't believe. Even like the disciples. But when they refused to believe, Jesus kept his peace. Why? Because if it is not of faith, it is sin. You can't convince someone of these things. They must see it and believe it for themselves. They must study to show themselves approved unto God. They must seek to know God's will and understand it for themselves. And so let us not put the blame at God's feet, but let us look at our own selves and see, am I believing God? Am I trusting God? And then the answer will come. Because if we will believe, then we will know.